first Trinity County Board of Supervisors meeting. Thank you everyone for coming. Mr. Supervisor Finley, can you give us some pledge?
My pleasure. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic which stands one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you.
All right, public comment?
Is it yours?
This time is for information from the public on matters not appearing on the agenda. All comments are limited to 3 minutes and must pertain to matters within the jurisdiction of this board. When addressing the board, please state your name for the record and address the board as a whole through the chair. No action or discussion will be conducted on matters not listed on the agenda. However, the chair may refer the subject matter to the appropriate department for follow-up or schedule a matter on a subsequent board agenda. Good morning.
Good morning. Kay Graves from Lewiston. Last week, our chairperson announced that there was no secrets from the public and that it wasn't hard to get public information and there's no Illuminati in the town. And I thought that was great news. Love hearing it. So I have a couple of copies that I've already given, but maybe they didn't get received where they needed to go. So I have a copy of a letter that we gave to the CAO and to Chairman Groves asking for election observers and some other small issues that we would like to have to secure our elections. And I never have heard from about this, even though I gave it to him on March 9th. I also have a copy of a request for Help America Vote Act money, grant money. I sent it in 2015 and again in 2017. I was replied to by your county council, but they gave me like 15% of the amount and considered that responsive. And I do not consider that responsive. So I'll give that to you. And I also have a more recent one to the Transportation and Building Department on code enforcement, asking for information on setbacks, their authority, their right-of-way, who has encroachment permits, and such. And I gave those to them over a month ago, and I haven't had a response of any kind from any of them. So this will be great, and I'll give them to you after the meeting. Thank you.
Go ahead and hand them to them.
Well, I don't have enough copies for everybody. Oh, but I could just give them to your clerk? Okay, that'll work. Thanks.
Hello, good morning. Honor Wright, Lewiston. I wanted to bring up a couple points in regards to our cannabis cultivation ordinance. There are some issues that I'm already seeing for a couple different things. One would be in regards to the renewal date. So as of now, the ordinance states in Section 2, Article 2, Section B, annual licenses shall run from April 1st to March 31st. It looks great on paper, however, that's not being in practice. I do have clients right now still waiting on their licenses that had applied before March 31st, so they're not going to get a full year out of their license. Something that I would propose to start thinking about would be anniversary dates to licenses. So instead of one renewal date, breaking that up throughout the year. So if a cultivator were to apply, let's say in May, they wouldn't have to renew until May of next year, giving them the ability to get a full year out of that license. That also would help your administration process it, because as of now, since I do have clients still waiting on licenses, there is a backlog. So that would help not only cultivators, but the planning department as well. Another point would be in regards to fees. Currently, we have one fee for both the application and for the license. Other counties and the state, they break that up to an application fee and a license fee. That way, you only pay a couple hundred dollars to apply, and if you are denied, you're only out a couple hundred dollars versus the full $6,000, $5,000, whatever license type you're applying for. That would help cultivators a lot, and that would make more sense instead of paying a flat fee when you may be denied. And then also in regards to fees would be the issue of the transferring of licenses. So currently in our ordinance, it states, Section 3, Article E, a licensee may transfer their license as part of the sale of the property for which the license is issued. The new owner shall reapply and repay the application fee, which again is that flat fee. That also is in regards to if you wanted to transfer your license to a different property you own. I understand the reapplication, absolutely. You want to make sure that that new owner or that new applicant is following the ordinance, such as being a Trinity County resident. I don't understand why they have to pay the full fee again. That seems grossly too much. A couple hundred dollars for the convenience of it, absolutely. But these are some issues that really need to start being addressed and agendized. More specifically, that anniversary date is something that's really, really important, so we can make sure that cultivators are getting a full year. For example, cultivators came in January 2018 asking for the new application, and they were giving a 17-18 application. And then they were confused why they had to pay another $6,000 for the 18-19 application. So being a little more transparent on that would be good too. Okay, thank you so much. Have a great day.
No other public comment? We'll bring it back to the board. First off, presentations. 1.1, receive a presentation from Sharon Scott with Let Go SOAR Ministries regarding the Hope House project.
This is my husband, Walt Scott. So it's not mentioned in there, but he's here as
well. Yeah. Did you want to link this up?
I just wanted to give the board a quick little they're just doing a they wanted to update the board on their project that they've been working on in the community, and it's a private nonprofit, and they just wanted to get the board and the public what they're up to. So that's why they're here to present.
Good morning, Mr. Gross. Thank you for allowing us to speak. It's an honor. Mr. Coons, it's really nice to see you again. We're Walt and Sharon Scott from Let Go and Soar Ministries, and we have spearheaded a project. It's been ongoing since about November of last year regarding a homeless shelter here in Trinity County, which will fill the gap between, actually provide a platform for our resident homeless. We're not speaking of the transient homeless who pass through here frequently. More so about the resident homeless is what we speak of. We do know and are encouraged that there are some projects ongoing at this time regarding temporary housing, and we're very encouraged about that. This will provide the beginning phase for that, and the reason that's necessary is because you cannot take a homeless person and plop them into an apartment. It does not work. They need skills, they need to learn how to live in a structure. And that's something that we would like to provide down the road. But first and foremost, the shelter will be about an 8 to 10 bed facility. It's gonna be small to start off. And we want to provide, of course, beds, meals, showers, clean clothes, the basic necessities of life. Beyond that, of course, we will be providing spiritual
guidance,
that's the good one, if they request that. If not, that's just fine. That's not a requirement of coming in. We, beyond that, would like to provide services in conjunction with HRN, Behavioral Health, and all of the other agencies that are so wonderful within Trinity County, but we would like to be the one place that is a resource for the references to these different agencies. If we need to take them there, we will. If we need to bring someone in, we're hoping for medical, dental, psychological, legal help from the area citizens within Trinity County. And this is a project that we are not going to be running on our own. What we are really looking at is, on a large scale, everyone within the community pitching in to help. And that sounds like a lofty goal, but we have, our support is gaining momentum. We've raised, as from our CFO, we've raised...
Well, we're only about $1,600 now, but we're working on it.
That's half full, half empty. I say we've raised almost $1,600 so far. We do have needs, of course, a lot of needs at this time. The reason that we want to do it is probably best explained by my husband. He's been working with the homeless people, a resident homeless.
About 5 years.
Yeah.
Well, I've been spending a lot of time, not a lot of time, probably only once a week or so down Leaf Farm Park, so I got to know the guys and the girls fairly well, and they trust me, and they would be willing, I think, once we had a place for them to go to get off the street, because if you just walked up as a stranger and asked them how they're doing, they'd say, oh, they're doing fine, they're happy, everything's great, but that's not the story. I think we all recognize that, and can acknowledge and understand that there is definitely a need, and they can do better, and they can be better. And that's what we want to do, is try to put some value and some self-worth and some self-esteem back into their lives, so they're actually willing to go out and want to do something, have that desire to do something besides sit down in the park and drink and smoke a pot, whatever else, all day long. So what we basically would want to do is, we're working on, we have a lady that works on grants for us right now. She's working with, in conjunction with someone else that understands that aspect of it. But what we need really, basically right now, besides, of course, money, is a property, a place that is not close to, so close to residential areas that would cause a problem there, but that is close to town, very close to town, so that we have access to all services, all city and county services, and so that we can probably have to transport people to and from the places that they need to go and the place they need to be. And you know, I know that, of course, we want to purchase this property. We don't want to necessarily be under any restrictions as far as leasing is concerned or that type of thing, but eventually we want to get there. We want to be able to do that, and that's probably one of our main goals right now, besides acquiring the property and acquiring a 501c3 specifically for the Hope House. We already have one ourselves, but Hope House has to have their own. So that's kind of where we're at as far as progress is concerned. Go ahead.
Okay. A lot of people, not a lot of people, some people have asked us, why do we think this is necessary? If you, public comment has been very negative over the years from our experience. A lot of people are complaining over and over and over again. And just 2 weeks ago, or was it last week, we had another violent confrontation.
It's been 3 weeks now, maybe.
And over and over again, the people are being beaten up badly. And I don't know if you've noticed, but that doesn't seem to be very effective with regard to getting them out of the county. It's not working. What we would like to do is speak into them and let them know that they do have value, that they deserve respect, that they deserve honor, and there is a way to get to that point in life where they can become contributing members of our county. It also will improve the life of everyone in the county, as my husband likes to say, because when your relatives come up or when we have tourists come up, they notice. They see people walking the streets, and it's become more and more. We at one time owned a store on Main Street, and it did affect our business. So, what we would like from the board is if you would consider your at least moral support, and understand the heart behind what we're doing, and consider, how can we help? Now, we're not necessarily talking about financial help, although that's great. If you know anyone who has property, if you know anyone who has a building or the wherewithal to help us to achieve this goal, we would truly appreciate that.
Well, I think that's it. The incident we're talking about is the gentleman that got beat up a little bit. He's still in the Vibra Rehabilitation Hospital right now after spending some time up here in this hospital. And three gentlemen, or maybe four now, have been arrested for doing that. And that's just the one time that they arrested somebody. There's been other times. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. Thank you for presenting. Okay, we're on to the consent calendar. These items include routine, non-controversial matters that will be acted upon by the board by one roll call motion. A member of the board, staff, or public may request an item to be pulled and considered separately. Board, Bobby, do you have anything? No. I have nothing. Staff, anything to be pulled? Public?
You go to second.
All right. Roll call vote, please.
Supervisor Finley?
Yes.
Supervisor Morris?
Yes.
Supervisor Chadwick?
Yes.
Supervisor Mines?
Yes.
Supervisor Post?
Aye. So that's the first for me.
Wow. First one?
Not having anything for it.
Oh, wait a minute.
Too late. That's a damn deal. Okay, reports and announcements, 3.1. Reports from department heads. Any department heads wishing to give a report? I see one violently shaking her head no. Careful of the chair. The trap chair is the one that's in the spot.
I'm good at standing on the stand.
Just don't lean back.
Okay. Shannon White, third recorder assessor. I wanted to give an update on said by last report, and Daryl Forslund was supposed to be here, but he has stepped out. I wanted to give you an update of what has transpired in my office since my last announcement. Locks on all the doors have been changed, and only the clerk recorder assessor staff has keys to those offices. Room 112 has been set up for all the elections processes. That's the remodel that we did, the big windows so that observers can watch processes. There are two offices off of that room, one being mine. There's been a lock put on the inside of the 112 room so that I cannot access that office. The other office that accesses that room 112 is my assistant's office. So that's all I had, and then Darrow was going to give an update on what's going on with the election, so if there's any way we can bring him back when he gets here. He said he had to step out just for a couple minutes. I don't know if that's okay or not.
Yes, I would be willing to bring him back.
Thank you.
Any other department heads? All right. On to the report from the CAO.
I have nothing to report.
Okay. Members of the Board of Supervisors, Ms. Chadwick.
Yes. I was going to congratulate him on the opening house. I'm sure Mr. Finley will expound on that. And we had a community action partnership with Glenn and Calusa in Portland last week. And maybe Terry would like to report on that.
Microphone.
Thank you. I can't hear you. Thank you. Sorry. And then on the 28th, was the Haycorp Volunteer Fire Department Award Ceremony. That was wonderful. Really glad to see so many new volunteers. There's quite a bit, so Haycorp is looking really good. Okay.
Supervisor Morris.
Well, let's see. A week ago, up in Wairika with our quarterly NCRP meeting, we will be rolling out solicitation for the first round of Prop 1 money in about 4 months, roughly. So I'll be bringing more information, and all the participating counties will certainly be alerted on the various projects that can be applied for. Also, didn't want to forget, CAO Coons and I were able to attend the HRM Prevention Squad event last night, and those teams did a great job, and in involving the community and issues that they face. So, thank you, CIO, for joining me.
Okay, Supervisor Mines.
Yeah, and like Ms. Chadwick said, we had the CIP meeting down in Orland, actually, with Coolidge and Glen County.
We really can't hear back here.
I'm sorry.
I don't think your microphones are on.
We went down to a meeting, a CAP meeting down in Orland, which was really a, it's a really positive meeting, which is for the three counties which get together and really push to help the disadvantaged people of our community. It's really positive and it's really going well, where we feed off of each other on positive things, and then if something doesn't go well, everybody doesn't try the things that don't go well. One county does a pretty good job of taking care of that. So other than that, that was it for me. Thank you.
Supervisor Fenley.
You got it. April 19th through 20th, I was in Redwood City for CalBHBC, California Association of Local Behavioral Health and Commissions. And then on the 26th of this month, last month, I was in Anderson for NORTEC. That's my out-of-county travel.
Okay, and I had no out-of-county travel. All right. At this time, we had a request to bring Darrow back up because he had to step up. So, Darrow, if you give a report on what's going on in the election.
I think Sean was going to.
Thank you for, okay, for letting Darrow come up. Yeah.
Sean had already
started. Okay. So, just a couple of things I wanted to bring everybody up to date on. The posting and publishing will be starting pretty quickly. Posting at the courthouse will be in the glass doors at the corner where the board packets are normally posted. Of course, published in the paper, the Trinity Journal, and on our website. Notice is that we expect to have all of the vote-by-mail ballots in the mail by the 7th, this next Monday. So people should be starting to expect to see their mail ballots coming in shortly after that. Somewhere around the 9th, assuming we've got some. As soon as we start receiving vote-by-mail ballots, we will be verifying those signatures. We do that daily, because if we've got a ballot that has a signature that we're not sure of, wasn't signed, or has a bad address, it gives us an opportunity to contact the voter and let them correct that issue so that we can count their ballot. So it's, if, the sooner we can process those ballots, the better off we are from the standpoint of having given them time to make that correction. So basically, as of the 7th, one of the things that we're going to be doing is asking everybody to, as of the 7th, we could possibly have somebody voting a ballot in the courthouse at that point in time. We don't have really early voting, but people can pick up an absentee ballot there and vote it. So as of the 7th, we're going to be asking everybody to remove their political signs from within 100 feet of the courthouse, just as a cautionary, just to make sure that somebody hasn't got a ballot that and there's some political signs within 100 feet, which is the requirement at all polling places. We've got voting equipment preparation still being worked on. As soon as we have some additional information from our vendor, we will be preparing our voting machines. That will be open for observation. All of the observation will still be in room 112. That gives us the opportunity to work daily in there. If we try to move downstairs, basically we would end up by having to probably use that conference room for the whole month, and it really isn't very likely that we're going to do that. So we'll be processing ballots under observation. We'll be preparing the voting machines under observation, doing an LNA testing on our observation and that sort of thing. So that's all be happening in the next couple of weeks. We will be providing notice as to when things are happening, but you should expect probably to be seeing ballots being verified on around the 9th of May. So. And of course, we'll be open for observation for any time we're actually doing any work in there. So, I think Shannon's already talked about the way she's changed the locks and that sort of thing, so we've restricted access as we can. So, I think that's really, my main issue was really to let you know that we are expecting ballots to be mailed from Sacramento on the 7th, and that as of that date, we'll be enforcing the 100-foot signs around the courthouse. And we are actually going to measure 100-foot circle around the courthouse. So we're not saying from any particular point, but from every corner of the courthouse, we'll be measuring out that distance and asking people to either remove their signs or not place them there if they're not there already. So that's what I had.
Yes, go ahead.
You used an acronym, and I didn't quite catch it. I think you said
LNA. LNA, sorry.
Can you say
logic and logic and accuracy testing. What we do is we mark a deck of ballots with a known result. What happens, the first position gets one mark, the second position gets two marks, that sort of thing. So then we run those ballots through the machines to make sure the machines are counting those ballots correctly. So we do that. The LNA is a we do it all the time, but basically, and we do it several times during the process to make sure the machines are all counting correctly. So.
Any other questions? There was talk originally of working with the grand jury to have two observers in there.
We are reaching out to the grand jury, asking them to provide us with grand jury observers, yes. So haven't worked out the timing of that yet, but we have talked to them, and they're willing to provide us with observation people. So.
All right. I take it you have some more to add?
I just wanted to make one clarification. We would not be, not accepting the mail ballot if the address was incorrect. We would just be we would still be counting that ballot.
Yeah, so what we're doing is getting we don't want to have people with bad addresses in our voting system. And so if the address is incorrect, we will contact, I think that's correct. We will still be counting that ballot. But we certainly want that information correct, because the correct address is going to tell us what precinct they belong to. And so if they've got a bad address, we really need to get that corrected. So. But we will be providing opportunities for them to let us know what their issue is, if they've got a different address or something like that. So.
All right, thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Rick, you were a little late, so did you want to give department head a point?
Just a real quick announcement for tomorrow. Our summer pavement program is going to begin. We've finally collected enough funds from SB1, the new gas tax, to allow us to go, and we're going to be doing about 10,000 square feet of patch pavement in downtown Trinity Center tomorrow, fixing Mary Street, and then about 2 months we'll start chip sealing the list that you guys had approved last year on the road. So I just wanted to let people know that we are going to be out there working tomorrow and starting to do the things that these new gas tax allows us to do.
Any questions, Rick? All right, thank you, Rick. Okay.
Chair, I apologize. This is not really a department head report, it's just an announcement. I don't know if this would be an appropriate time.
Yes.
So the planning department has been organizing the zoning ordinance to make sure that it's up to date and that it is accurate. So at this point, they are making an amendment and putting all cannabis-related items under Section 42. So it's a procedural change. It will just happen, but you may see some differences in our numbering. 43. I apologize, 43. You will see some changes in terms of how they're being numbered, but the contents will all be the same. It's just a numbering correction that we're making, just to make sure that it has its own section and it's clear for the future.
Okay, we're on to reports from the ad hoc committees. Anything from the legislation of cannabis from the state?
Nope, not from me.
Just banking and taxation is moving through. We'll see if it stops.
Okay. The commercial cannabis ordinance?
Well, as we mentioned last week, we sent Type 9 back to the commission. So that will be coming back to the board. Micro business will be coming back to the board. We have today manufacturing, so a series. We will do a cleanup. Did that young lady leave?
Yes.
Okay, well, as she's new to the party, but as we've discussed many times, we are doing some cleanup language on some of those things she raised. We've already adjusted the renewal date in some of these corresponding ordinances for testing, nursery. What else did we do on the renewal date?
I
think all the ordinances, cultivation, we are adjusting that renewal date. So we'll see some more cleanup language and cultivation down the road.
Okay, I have nothing to add. On to the jail detention facility.
Just two quick updates. The fire marshal is reviewing the second submittal for construction, and then we're attempting to schedule the ground lease meeting with the Department of Finance. Hopefully that'll happen shortly.
All right, the 2005 COP refinancing?
I think that's going to be addressed in 4.3 today, so I'll leave that for Terry.
Budget development?
Budget is moving. Thank you, Susie, for all that prep work and the auditor's office.
The wilderness oversight, John, you want to start?
I have nothing to add to it. You know what's going on, you can talk about it. Lucky you.
So I have been taking input from different industries and stakeholders groups in this. We are meeting with Congressman Huffman to voice our concerns and thoughts. We've requested better mapping, we've requested the cleaner copy of the legislation, and we hope to have more answers coming out of for our next meeting on what they're up to.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
I did respond to John Driscoll as far as he sent a synopsis of the bill, but there was no bill number, and I haven't been able to find it. Do you have any?
So there is no bill number because it hasn't been submitted yet. So interestingly enough, you can find it on the older version on the Wilderness and Rivers website. Is that what it is?
They're going to change it, so who knows how long that will stay. They're very unhappy with that name.
Yes, so there's a Wilderness and Rivers website. And on the congressman's website, there's a draft bill there.
I saw that, but...
That's all there is.
That's
there,
it.
There is nothing else. It has not been submitted to Congress yet, or to either House.
So the information is very skimpy, and that's one of our big issues. And the map is just a very basic, here's a line, and there's no topo maps, you can't zoom in on it. It's very crude at this time.
I'm glad that I wasn't the only one that thought that.
Right.
Appreciate it.
Everybody okay? All right. On to county matters. These items include non-routine or non-routine or controversial matters that are listed alphabetically by department. A member of the board or staff may request this item be heard out of order. Do we have anything wanting to be heard out of order? Nope, since she's sitting down already. Okay, 4.1, Health and Human Services. Modify the allocation list for Health and Human Service Department. Human Service Division to read as follows. 11, social worker, 1 or 2 or 3 or 4, effective May 1st, 2018, and direct said changes made to the allocation list. Approximate cost and salary and benefits per month for social worker 1 at step A is $4,796. For social worker 2, step A is $5,217. For social worker 3, at step A is $5,682. And for social worker 4, step A is $6,195.
Good morning. Shelley Nelson, HR Director, and Lady Burris is here, Director of Health and Human Services. And Health and Human Services has had a staffing change. That's the reason for the request to increase the allocations of the social worker portion. This would be in the welfare division of the department.
No, like the staff report stated, this position would be focused more on working with the young adult population. So your approval with this would probably support that function.
Okay, any questions? Questions from the public on this item? All right, with that, we bring it back to the board.
So moved.
Second, 4.1 as presented.
Any discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign.
Thank you.
All right. Next item, planning and zoning, 4.2. Waive the reading and enact an ordinance amending the Trinity County zoning ordinance 3.15 by adding section 443.2 regarding cannabis manufacture, introduced April 17, 2018. Fiscal impact unknown. Thank you, Supervisor Mines.
Good morning.
Okay.
All right.
Yes.
Okay, so board members, this item was before us last meeting, April 17th, at which point there were no comments to the item. It's been before the PC back in October and I believe November or December. So it's been before the commission twice. Of course, this is manufacturing under today's state regulations, which there weren't any in the last 20 years until recently. So, however, we have received, all of you probably have received comments on some issues around Lewiston and having some discussion around the carve-out on Lewiston. So any real major change we make will have to come back to the board, and if it's a land use item, certainly has to be filtered back through the Planning Commission. So it is, I spoke to my colleague on the ad hoc chair that maybe it's our best recommendation if the board agrees that we skip right to the end and send this back to the Planning Commission for them to review the following items, the historic carve-out for Lewiston, historic carve-out for Weaverville, and have them review. One thing we didn't do is review the Ag Preserve. So even if we were all in agreement, it would still have to go to the Planning Commission, so I thought it would save everybody some time and send it back to the commission, unless the board does not want that to happen.
I would. The comments were not on the Lewiston area. We're not just for the historic.
Oh, okay. Carve-out.
So it's the entire carve out. We would like them to take a look at in that situation. So the procedure is that this is the board's will. We would send it down, and then we would take comments only on if we felt this was a good idea to send it down or not a good idea, and then all comments would be moved to the Planning Commission when it hears there as soon as we can possibly get it there, which I believe is
the 24th. This is the soonest we could get it.
Yeah,
there.
The 24th would be the soonest we could get it there.
Because of noticing requirements.
Correct. There would be a 10-day notice period if we have a public hearing for changes to it, so that would be the 24th.
So with that, we would. Help me out here, Counselor.
Any questions from the board?
We'll take questions from the board and then open up to the public on the issue of moving it down to Planning Commission.
Okay.
So we're just temporarily tabling it.
Yeah.
In essence, it's all.
Nope, no questions.
Okay. So that we would ask for public comment on if this should go to the commission or not.
Have been asking anything for it? Is it possible for it to go back for review just for those areas and people in other areas unaffected can still be moving forward with the process? Thank you.
Hi, I'm just new to the process, so it's more of a question. When you say send to the Planning Commission, is it so they can decide if those carve-outs that you mentioned are incorporated?
The Planning Commission gives recommendations to the board and under state law that they have to look at all land use issues before it comes to us. So people would go give testimony, they would give a recommendation, and then it could come to the board where we would accept it or not accept it.
Thank you.
Okay, with that, we'll bring it back.
I would ask council, because there's, it's a little nuanced, and we have moved forward ordinances in the past and peeled off slices to go back to the commission. Kevin, who participates a lot in these processes, thank you, asked a very important question. This is a slightly different than what we've done in the past, because in the past, things weren't allowed to begin with. So maybe you could explain it better, but in essence.
Sure, so that is an option to do it. The problem it raises for staff and for the public is we don't know what the Planning Commission is going to recommend. If we allow this ordinance to go through, there will be allowed manufacturing in, let's say, Lewiston, for example, until it comes back to them. So individuals could apply for and get licenses that are later going to have to be pulled from them, which does create a problem from our perspective, from a staff's perspective. So you're right, it's different than in the past where things have been given. This is going to be things that are potentially taken away. So it does have that minor nuance.
All right. Would you like a motion on this?
I would like a motion.
I move that we send item 4.2 back to the Planning Commission to have them review the following items: Ag Preserve, the historic Weaverville as a carve out, and the existing carve out Lewiston boundary lines.
You've got a second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All right, thank you. And we hope to have that date on the 24th. Well, we will have that date on the 24th, correct? Okay. With that, we'll move on to 4.3, Treasurer Tax Collector. Take the following actions regarding 2005 Certificates of Participation. Approve an agreement with Oric, Harrington, and Sutcliffe LLP to provide bond counsel service. 2, approve an agreement with Brandis Tallman LLC to provide placement agent service. And 3, provide direction to staff regarding the preferred structure for the refinancing. Potential total savings of approximately $500,000 once refinanced, with the following expenses being taken off the top: $23,500 for bond counsel expenses and $17,500 for placement agent expenses. CAO, is it Terry leading?
Yes, Terry.
Okay. Good morning.
Good morning. Terry McBrayer, Treasurer, Tax Collector. The items that you have before you are related to the refinancing of the COPs, and for the public that is not familiar with that, it's Certificate of Participation. The contracts that you have are basically, they don't meet the threshold that would be required to come before you, but this has kind of been a controversial topic, so I thought I would bring that to you anyway so that we could just be more transparent with the public. But I'd like to provide a little bit more, a little bit of history for those that are not familiar with this. Basically, at the time when the COPs were issued, the county, the big major factor that contributed to this was the fact that the hospital was a county hospital, and we were basically in a very weakened condition. There was an operating deficit that we weren't able to get out of, and we were basically at bankruptcy's doors where we were, and so we didn't have many options. And while some will argue that we spent hundreds of thousands of dollars of that, if we had to file bankruptcy, we would be in the millions of dollars. So basically, while I wasn't a part of that, I can tell you that the hundreds that we spent are way better than where we would have been if we would have gone to the millions of dollars. And so we are in a much better state than where we were at that time. So just wanted to kind of provide that little piece before moving on to the next part. So. Basically, where we're at now, the contracts that you have are for, I've met with the ad hoc committee, and so we're in a position now where it's appropriate, where I think it'd be fiscally beneficial for us to pursue refinancing this. And so we've all met, and the two contracts are, one is for, Oric is for a bond counsel, And so we've got some goals in mind that ideally I'm hoping that we can actually meet all of these goals. Some of those would be, well, number one, we'd like to lower the interest rate. The other would be removing the restrictions. We have two restrictions. One is that we actually have, one is we have a reserve account that was required because we were in such dire straits at the time. They made us put money in a reserve account that we can't touch or do anything about. Those monies are still there. I think that we'll be able to take those monies out of that reserve account and then be able to basically, it'll shorten the length of the time of the loan. I think that one's a realistic goal. I don't think that'll be a problem that we'll be able to meet. The others that I'm not as sure about would be if we can unencumber one of the buildings that we have. So we'll have, we have both the courthouse as well as the juvenile hall. And so those are two of the things. And basically, I think that we, hopefully we should, because basically the amount of what we have left, both the two buildings, exceed what we have left, and so I don't know that that's necessary, but we would need bond counsel to verify that for us, and so that's what I believe the goal is. And the restrictions for our, we can't basically have a reserve because that's the other requirement that we have there, so I guess you all are fully aware of that one. So that was the other major restriction that we had. So, and the other contract we have there would be to, Brenda Stellman is for a placement agent. So in with refinancing a bond like this, basically we, with the size of this still, it's more beneficial to have a private placement. And so that's what this particular contract is for. And so with our ad hoc committee, we did do an RFP, we did meet, and we did discuss the different those that submitted to us, and these are the companies that we did select, and so they did come in. Actually, I think they came in some of the lower ones, but we did provide there for you in the packet what the estimated savings would be over the time. The other thing that I did need direction on also was for the what recommendation was as far as direction on the type of structure that we would choose for refinancing. We did talk with a few people on the ad hoc committee or also on the budget committee, and I spoke in depth with the auditor's office. Those are also on the jail committee, because that's one thing that I did see that would be a, as far as the cash flow for my office, I needed to know where we were invoicing and what was going to be an impact on my office as far as what we were talking about in coming and outgoing cash flow wise. And we do not see that that's going to be an issue as far as when I was looking at what type of restructuring we were doing. And so in discussing that with everybody, we do recommend that we were to do level savings. There's different types of financing that we could do. And so we do need your direction as far as what type of savings, because there's different types of ways to refinance that, but that is something I would need your direction on as well.
Okay, any questions?
I have.
Org's contract is something that you are looking for approval on today. I misunderstood. It sounded like they didn't meet our minimum requirements.
Say that again?
Does org meet our minimum requirements? They did not.
I'm sorry. What I meant to say was, I was trying to say for the public that the reason I'm not required to bring it to the board,
okay,
because the threshold is below the 30,000.
So
I'm just bringing it so that the public
perfect.
Can see that we're bringing it so that the public is aware of why, you know, that this is who
Terry,
we selected.
If you keep our fingers out of it, I approve.
Yeah.
You know that.
But I wanted everybody to be aware of what we're doing
perfect
with the financing, but that's why I'm here.
Perfect.
Any other questions, Karen?
Go ahead, Bobby Huber.
Yes, just on the contract under the bid amounts, there's another acronym, and I apologize that I didn't send this to you ahead of time. It says plus NTE, and I don't know.
Oh, not to exceed.
Okay, thank you.
Question, Terry, remind me again on the private placement versus the other option.
So private placement, so I guess basically like a longer story short, so number one, our port, we're not rated, and so that's very expensive. So if we go out to market, basically what savings we get, it's gonna eat up our savings.
That's right.
Okay. And so what, because we're so small.
That's right.
And the last time when I was going back and looking through some of this stuff, we had people that pulled out that they wouldn't even, they didn't want it. It's such a small deal, they weren't interested.
That's right. You refreshed my memory. Thank you.
Okay. With that, we'll open up to the public. Any questions for the public?
Kay Grace from Lewiston. I'm a little confused. This seems less of a refinancing and more of a reselling of the bond. And I'm curious if that's how this is being handled. Also, I would like to say that this deal with the co-op did not save us money when we spent over $5 million just in, it'll be less, but we'll spend millions in interest, and we already have. And I still say this was an illegal bond. It was illegally done, and the purpose was not met. And I would prefer that we didn't have it, and we weren't paying interest on it at all. And now we're gonna pay more bond people for, and I hope we save money on it, but if we're saving the money on something we shouldn't ever have to pay. I get that the county was going to be insolvent, but two wrongs don't make a right, and that's what we did. And we would have bounced back like the other places that have gone bankrupt, and it would have given us a chance to reorganize, and I think we should have taken that, and this wasn't the path that I would have chosen. It might have been the easier one, but it's a shame. And to say this saves us money, it will, because of what we're gonna have to pay in the long run, but it's money we should have never had to pay.
Any other public comment? I will point out for the record that when this was done, I probably still had hair, so I wasn't part involved in this. So all we can do is move forward and not look backwards. So why don't we look at these one at a time, on the 1 through 3. There's no other discussions. The first item she's requesting is approving an agreement with Warwick Harrington's set up to the bond council.
Are you taking them together?
No, I'm going to take them one at a time.
I'll move to approve part one, item one of 4.3. I don't know if we have to, but I agree. We do have to.
Okay.
Thank you.
All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All right. Second item, approve an agreement with Brandis Talman LLC. Or placement services.
I'd move to approve item 2.4.3 if we have to. I'm not sure that we. Oh, never mind. Okay. Move to approve. Oh, come on. Just you know, either speech up or let it die.
All right. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Same sign. Okay. And provide direction to staff on the preferred structure. I believe as a refinance committee, I forget your term you used, a linear?
Level savings.
Level savings, which would mean spreading the savings over a whole, every year, so there would be approximately $60,000 to $70,000 a year savings, something like that. Is that correct?
Yes, and I anticipate that when we take the reserve funds that we have, that's going to shorten. That'll take probably the last year off of the loan.
And so our other options are just to take it up front, take it in the rear, but the budget committee, or not the budget committee, the
refi
committee suggested. Discussions, thoughts, questions?
Year after year versus one lump sum?
Yeah.
Generally, normally you do that if we had, if we knew we had a need for that, and then normally we'd have to provide justification for that need, and then along with that, we'd have to provide the justification to the purchaser, the first purchasing us, to say that this is what we're doing and this is why we're doing that.
The reason this came up originally was over the jail funding and,
right,
and having to have some cash flow, but I'm being assured by the that cash flow will be worked out without having to put that lump sum.
That was my question. Thank you.
Well, if you're assured, I'm assured.
And I'll move to approve.
I'll second.
And that's the
with the level.
Level
savings.
Please forward that into the motion.
I move to approve the level savings avenue.
Yeah. I'll second as amended.
Okay. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. All right. Thank you, Terry.
Thank you, Terry.
For being involved in this.
Thank you.
All right. The Trinity County Transportation Commission. Appoint the following people to serve, and I was a little confused on this. Are we acting as the commission to do this, or are we acting as board supervisors to appoint these?
Board supervisors.
Okay, thank you.
Because the commission would not have authority to appoint that.
Okay, thank you.
So the county council says. County council goes.
She's on a roll today. Appoint the following people to serve on a steering committee for the development of the Trinity County Active Transportation Plan. Sally Cousins, Marina Irwin. Can you help me on the next name?
Nope.
Say that again.
Hi, Alatia. Thank you very much. Scott Morris, Katie Quinn, Sarah Sapaha, Tom Evans, and one member of the Board of Supervisors. Go ahead, Rick. Start us off.
Thank you. Through the alternative transportation plan, known as ATP and Caltrans, there's about $250 million a year that's allocated to non-motorized transportation. And it's been one of the frustrating things because rural counties have not had very good luck with it. But the one thing we did have luck was we secured $100,000 a year and a half, 2 years ago, to do a bike, essentially update our bike master plan and a non-motorized plan so that we could tie things together here in the community. As we do with the regional transportation plan, when we do major updates, we like to appoint a steering committee so we don't bring every little issue to here. We had a chance to discuss it with the group and then bring the issue as a whole to the board for final consideration. So with that, I was requesting these people to be appointed. They were all requestees, and then we asked that one person be appointed from the board.
I'm happy to serve on the committee.
Anybody else have an interest?
I sit on stack as it is, so it kind of seems like it'd be a natural fit, but I think both of us could find.
Do you find? We both sit on that stack.
Yeah.
It could be the board's will to appoint two, so.
Okay.
I think we did last time. I think it was Supervisor Fisher and Supervisor Burgess. We had coverage on each side of the bill. Does that ring a bell?
I don't recall. Sorry.
Okay. Any other comments from?
I was just wondering how the people, did we request these people or did they request, and if they request, how they knew?
It's my understanding is it was these were people that had requested or mainly had been involved in this activity in the past couple of years. We've had certain groups like the trail group and a bicycle group, and so these were people that were actively involved in those groups already, and they stepped up and offered to provide this assistance. And we try to look for someone involved, something like this, we try to look for the active participants that understand what's going on so that they can roll right into providing assistance, the technical assistance we need. This group is a technical group that is offering specific information. It's not meant to be more generalized. Those comments come through the public process where we have workshops and meetings as we move this forward.
So we requested them based on their past participation?
Yes.
They were the last formation, many of
those
people.
Well, a lot of them come from already formed groups.
So you got money for this bike thing. What other kind of like non-motorized like things would you be trying to get money for? Like what else is out there? I mean, I was joking. I wanted a Segway.
Motorized.
Non-motorized. Right, non-motorized. I know something. And a Segway is motorized.
Yeah.
You know, it's well, thing like bicycles. What else? Are there, is this skateboarding? Would this get us money for a skateboard park for the kids?
Usually it's non, or it's active transportation, which is non-motorized. And it's meant to be going from point A to point B. So things that are outside of bike trails or bikeways, Trinity is populated quite immensely with hiking trails. And so one of the things that I'm hoping to get out of it is a county map that ties everything together. So that instead of coming off the Forest Service, getting the Forest Service map and getting the Weaver Valley Trail map and getting whatever, BLM map, that you can have one map to go to. Those are the kind of things that this would be dealing with.
That would help immensely.
Mm-hmm. But a skating park.
Is that not transportation?
Yeah, it's not transportation.
I just wasn't sure exactly what other kind of things that you could go after that would help. But the mapping would be important. That would be amazing. That would help with all the ability for us to get more tourism here, for sure.
Okay. Good.
Okay, any other questions? With that, we'd open it up to the public. Okay.
Wait a minute.
Well, she talked you into it.
Yeah. Since there's only with one supervisor, there'd be eight members to the board. I'd like to have them. Two supervisors, that way be an uneven number.
Okay. All right, with that, we bring it back to the board.
Unless Terry wanted to do it since his predecessor was part of it.
That's what I was actually thinking. It seemed like Bill Burton's thing with the bike trail. Yeah, that's fine.
I'm
happier
than you two.
All right, I think it's a good idea to have two supervisors. It's a big county. It's impossible for one to know the whole county. So so we would accept this first, and then I would appoint the two supervisors.
Okay.
You want a motion?
Yes, please.
Make a motion to accept Trinity County Transportation Commission item 4.4 with the change of two Board of Supervisors also on this committee with chosen at the chair's pleasure.
I'll second.
Okay, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed, same side. Okay, so I will appoint Supervisor Mines and Supervisor Chadwick to this commission.
I thought you said.
Okay.
Unless. Did I miss
anything?
No, that's
right.
No.
Perfect.
I'm happy to do it, but I thought.
Oh, no, that's
okay.
Good.
Thanks. All right. Closed session. Oh, wait a minute. We have an addendum. And pursuant to the county policy 3-93, find no objection to the issuance of a catering authorization to C&G Foods for Diamond W Productions to serve alcohol during 4th of July activities in the Marina area of the Loudoun Park in Weirville, California on June 29th, 30th of 2018. With that, this is an alcohol issue and I will refuse and hand this over to Vice Chair.
All right.
Thank you.
go too far away. All right, any questions from the board? Does he just did read the item?
Yeah, he opened it.
Any comments from the public? Oh, here we go. All right.
I'd just like to comment that I know this was done a while back, and I think it's a shame that the county okayed this over the Weaverville Lions Club, who used to hold this, and they make quite a bit of money, which was used locally. I'm pretty sure the Lions Club would like to have this back, and I don't know if the county would even consider doing that, but to give it to an outside business, because they have local ties, is not the same as letting a volunteer organization make money that they use inside this community all year long. And if there's some way it could be given back to them, that would be great. Thank you.
Just for the record, the Lions are still involved, and this is only for 2 days of that holiday weekend. So I'm sure you'll be seeing a Lions alcohol license coming.
Also, how is Diamond Jubilee? Is it Diamond Jubilee?
Correct.
Are they, I assume they're local?
No.
They're owned by three. You
know,
they're owned by three owners.
They employ people at the board.
Right, that's right. So it still is working out.
Right.
Okay, thank you, Supervisor.
All right, bring it back to the board.
I'll make a motion to approve as presented the addendum.
Thank you. Do I have a second?
I second.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? All right, no. So moved. Thank you, board. All right.
Read the closed session.
Oh, no.
Oh,
I'm happy to.
All right. With that, we're going to move to closed session. Item 5.1, Government Code Section 54954.5, Conference with Legal Counsel, Litigation, Initiation of Litigation, one case. 5.2, Government Code Section 54954.5, Conference with Labor Negotiation, County Designee Representative David Prentice, Sophie Meyer, and Shelley Nelson. Employee Organization, Sheriff, Free Sheriff Association, Miscellaneous Police Officer, Skilled Trade Unit, Management and Confidential Unit, and General Unit. Is there any comment on the closed session today? All right, with that, we will take a 5 to 7 minute break while we clear the room and start closed session.